10 inches of water in our surge ponds. We've not had flooding there in 30 years. And our elevation is between 29 feet and 19 feet. There's many other areas of Timber Oaks the same way. It's only a small percentage of houses that are positively affected. And with the current situation for resources required all over the county, we think it's better resource to take care of that and to come up with a comprehensive plan for the Timber Oaks and adjoining areas to get the appropriate drainage. Because once you close off the Ranch Road drainage with a current project, it really stifles the next development to fix the problem. So I think let's not be too hasty. Let's take the time, do it right, so it doesn't have to be done in 10 or 15 years. Thank you.
Thank you for your input. Mark, how long have we been working on this and studying this?
Well, the county has been working on this project for a number of years. We've been working on it a great deal of staff time over the last year, working with the county on this, evaluating all the information. Again, back in June, we spent about an hour or two discussion with the board. We brought this item back in terms of our support of the project. It moved from a medium ranking to a high ranking. Based on the information, the cost has come down from $13 million to $9 million. And again, we have representatives from the county, the Homeowners Association, and the property owner that is all supportive of this project as we have recommended.
So your challenge has been to juggle all the groups and try to get a consensus, and you've gotten to that point now with consensus. We have a couple of board members who have some questions. Wendy, was that you? Carlos?
Mr. Chair, thank you. Mr. Hammond, do you have a permit?
They
have a permit? Have they permitted the site for these flood improvements?
The project will still have to be permitted, and so it'll go through.
That's actually perfect then.
Yes.
If the staff would take into consideration the gentleman's comments so that we don't put ourselves in a box.
Yes.
Because sometimes the rule of unintended consequences comes in and then we preclude something that's affecting somebody downstream.
That's a good point.
As long as you take those comments into consideration when you're doing the engineering solution, then I move to approve.
We have a motion to approve.
Do
we have a second?
For
we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion from the board or questions of staff? Hearing none, I'll call the question on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed?
Aye.
The ayes have it. The motion carried by. It sounded like a unanimous vote, and staff will work with the folks to take that into consideration. Thanks for that input, Mr. Baruth. Mark, we don't have anything else under the report except the request. Comments about Lake Pretty. You wanted to follow up because that was an example of some citizen input and staff giving us a report of the follow-up on that.
Yes, Mr. Chair, we had in your submitting file, there is a report. There was a gentleman that came in a couple months ago asking questions about a lake level. We sat down and addressed that and just provided a report to you in your packet there.
And we appreciate that and want the record to reflect that we did react and studied it further after the citizen gave us their input, and we appreciate that. The others are minimum flow level status report and significant water supply resource development projects, and they're under routine reports. Seeing no further business, I'll adjourn the Resource Management Committee and go back to you, Mr. Chairman, and you pass the gavel.
Pass it back to myself. I now call the order the General Counsel's report. We have no items for from consent moved for discussion, but I would like to take this time to ask the board. We will be here for some duration, and would anybody like to take a 5-minute break before we start, because we need everybody at the dais during this time. So why here, this would be a great time to take a break, because we will be here for quite some time. So I'm going to entertain a 5-minute break. We'll be back here at 9:20. And I'm going.
Is it going to mess up your time?
I'll tell you what. I'll tell you what. One day it'll be one paper.
This is who I got to the left.
Go ahead. And he removed the consent agenda.
I
call back our meeting back to order. General counsel, Ms. Karen West, please.
Thank you. excuse me. This item involves a proposed final order resulting from an administrative hearing before the Division of Administrative Hearings concerning a consolidated challenges to an environmental resource permit application and the district's proposed action on that application. The administrative law judge that presided over the hearing has entered a recommended order on this matter, and it is now in front of the governing board for consideration of a final order. The governing board has certain responsibilities at this stage of the proceeding. You're required to review the recommended order, the exceptions to the recommended order, which were filed by the respondents, and the response to those exceptions that were filed by the petitioners and interveners, and finally enter a final order. You cannot consider any new factual information at this stage and are confined to a consideration of the information contained in the hearing record, the recommended order, and the exceptions. Each of the parties, it will be provided an opportunity to present oral argument regarding the exceptions and the responses to the recommended order. Each respondent will be allotted 20 minutes to present its exceptions and an additional 10 minutes for rebuttal. Each respondent may also reserve any unused portion of their initial presentation for additional rebuttal. Because the petitioners and interveners did not file any exceptions and filed a joint response to the exceptions, they are allotted 20 minutes cumulatively for their presentation and no additional time for rebuttal. On the screen is the proposed order for oral arguments. First will be Mr. Douglas Manson for Respondent Land Trust 97-12. Chris Tanner, who represented the district during the hearing, will present second. And lastly, representatives for the petitioners and interveners. Because there was public comment taken during the administrative hearing pursuant to Chapter 120 Florida statutes, and because the board is acting in a quasi-judicial capacity at this stage of the proceeding, no additional public comment will be taken during the meeting. After oral argument has concluded, Amy Brennan of the Office of General Counsel will explain in detail the governing board's legal responsibilities with regard to considering the ALJ's recommended order and the proposed final order. Ms. Brennan was screened throughout the litigation and the hearing process, excuse me, up until the recommended order was issued, and will serve as the governing board's advisor during this part of the proceeding. She will present a proposed final order and ruling on each of the exceptions. Generally, the board can follow one of two basic courses with regard to the recommended order. First, you could adopt the ALJ's recommended order in total, or you could reject or modify findings of fact and conclusions of law. You can only modify or reject a finding of fact if you find that based on a complete review of the record that there was no competent substantial evidence presented to support that fact, or that the hearing or proceeding upon which that fact was based did not comply with the essential requirements of law. You can modify or reject a conclusion of law, but only after first stating with particularity the reason for rejecting or modifying the conclusion of law and having a conclusion that is as or more reasonable than that provided by the administrative law judge. Finally, the governing board may not take any action on the matter until the conclusion of the oral argument and the presentation by Ms. Brennan. During the oral argument, there may be factual statements made that are not currently part of the record and will generate an objection. At that point, the board would have to deal with those objections individually. The board has the option at this point to delegate to the chairman the authority to act on behalf of the board in dealing with those objections if and when any may arise. That would require at this point a motion and a second and a vote by the board to do that.
So moved.
Second.
We have a second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Okay.
At this point, Amy Brennan will go into a little more detail on the standard of review that the board can consider when considering the final order. And following that, then Chris Tanner will give a factual and procedural history of the case, how we got here to today, and then the start of the oral argument.
Good morning. My name is Amy Brennan from the Office of General Counsel. And before we get started this morning with the oral arguments on the exceptions, I thought it would be important for me to go through the standards of review that you will be using in considering the exceptions that the parties have filed and the proposed rulings on those exceptions. So as Ms. West just told you, the governing board is responsible for entering a final order in this proceeding. And as she also mentioned, pursuant to Section 12057-1L, the district can either adopt the ALJ's proposed recommended order in total or can reject or modify findings of fact and conclusions of law contained therein. There are different standards of review for findings of fact and conclusions of law, and your review is restricted to the record and no additional public comment will be taken. So the standard of review concerning findings of fact, the district may not reject or modify findings of fact unless it determines after a review of the entire record that the findings of fact were not based upon competent substantial evidence or the proceedings did not comply with the essential requirements of law. Overturning findings of fact is a very strict standard. If evidence is competent, it means that it is admissible under the legal rules of evidence. If it is substantial, it means that it will establish a substantial basis of fact from which the fact at issue can be reasonably inferred. It must be sufficiently relevant, and a reasonable mind must accept the conclusion, and it must have a definite probative value. Then ALJ may rely on the testimony of one witness, even if it was contradicted by the testimony of another witness. And the governing board may not reweigh any evidence on the record. If the governing board chooses to reject a finding of fact, it will have to do so based on a review of the entire record, including the hearing transcript and exhibits, which you were provided prior to today's meeting. If the findings of fact are supported by evidence in the record, the district will be bound by the ALJ's findings of fact. And again, the district has no authority to reweigh the evidence, build a new case, or make new factual findings. There is one exception to the standard of review pertaining to findings of fact that will be very important in this particular proceeding, and that is described in the Save Anna Maria case. That case involved an environmental permit under review by the Florida Department of Environmental Protection. And in that case, the court found that the permitting agency has the authority to determine the sufficiency of proposed mitigation. Therefore, an ALJ's findings related to the sufficiency of mitigation are essentially conclusions of law and are not binding upon the district. And the district can apply the standard of review to conclusions of law to findings of fact relating to mitigation. And in Exhibit E, where I have given you the proposed rulings on the exceptions, it specifically states when the Save Anna Maria standard is being applied. So with respect to conclusions of law, the district may reject or modify an ALJ's conclusions and or application of ALJ policy, so long as the district makes a finding that its substituted conclusion of law is as or more reasonable than that which was rejected or modified. In making such a finding, this is where the district can apply its experience, expertise, and policy. So do you have any questions at this time about the standard of review?
Does the board have any questions? No, ma'am.
Okay. At this point, I'd like to introduce Chris Tanner from the Office of General Counsel, and he will give you a factual history of the case.
Okay. I'm Chris Tanner. I'm a staff attorney in the district's Office of General Counsel, and I'll be providing a factual and procedural history of this proceeding. On August 21st, 2014, the district gave notice of its intent to issue an environmental resource permit to Land Trust number 9712 to construct a stormwater management system to support a 3.46-acre, four-lot, single-family residential project with associated access driveway to be known as Single Family Homes at Harbor Sound. The project site is located on the western shoreline of Perico Island in the city of Bradenton in Manatee County. I'm going to show you four exhibits from the file of record to help explain the project. All four exhibits were admitted into the file of record and admitted into evidence at the final hearing, labeled as Land Trust Exhibit 1. This is an aerial of the project site. The project site is next to Anna Maria Sound, which is an outstanding Florida water and part of the lower Tampa Bay. Land Trust owns a 40.36-acre parcel on Perico Island, on which the project site consists of 3.46 acres. The yellow line depicts the 40.36 acres owned by Land Trust. The project site is adjacent to a large multifamily residential development called Harbor Isles, which is currently under construction. The development, as you can see, is to the east and to the north of Land Trust parcel. Access to the Land Trust parcel is gained through the Harbor Isle development. Now, this is an aerial of the actual 3.46 acre parcel. The orange line is the mean high water line, which is at 1.33 feet. The yellow line is the 2-foot contour line. The green line is the proposed retaining wall, and the blue line is the wetland jurisdictional line. As mentioned, the proposed project includes the construction of a retaining wall. Fill will be placed behind the wall to create buildable lots for four single-family homes, the access driveway, and the stormwater management system. There are 1.9 acres of wetlands within the project area. The project originally proposed to impact 1.4 acres of wetlands, but the applicant decided to use a StormTech system instead of a surface water pond to reduce wetland impacts. Therefore, only 1.05 acres of wetlands will be filled in order to create the buildable lots. That is a reduction of 0.35 acres of impacts. The retaining wall will be constructed more than 35 feet from the mean high water line in most areas. Approximately 40 feet of mangroves will be left waterward of the retaining wall. Additionally, riprap will be placed on the waterward side of the retaining wall. Using the state's uniform mitigation assessment method, the district determined the filling of the 1.05 acres of wetlands would result in a functional loss of 0.81 functional units, and secondary impacts resulting from the installation of the retaining wall will result in a loss of 0.09 units for a total functional loss of 0.9 units. Land Trust proposed to mitigate for the loss in wetland functions resulting from the permanent filling and the secondary impacts by purchasing 0.9 forested credits from the Tampa Bay Mitigation Bank. The stormwater management system is a StormTech system, which is an underground system that will be located under the access driveway. The stormwater runoff within the project area will be collected through catch basins and directed to an underground chamber system. The system is designed to provide the required volume based on the district's presumptive water quality criteria and an additional 50% treatment volume to meet the district's design criteria for discharges to Anna Maria Sound, which is an outstanding Florida water. The procedural history. As mentioned, on August 21st, 2014, the district gave notice of its intent to issue an ERP to Land Trust number 9712. On August 29th, 2014, Joseph McClash filed for a petition for hearing to challenge the proposed ERP. On September 10th, petitioner Minnesota 88 filed a petition for hearing. And on September 18th, the Florida Institute for Saltwater Heritage, Inc. filed a petition for hearing. The district referred all three petitions to the Division of Administrative Hearing, and they were consolidated for final hearing. On August 26, Sierra Club Inc. moved to intervene in the proceeding, and on January 27, 2015, Suncoast Waterkeeper Inc. moved to intervene. The motions to intervene were granted. The final hearing in these consolidated cases were held February 17th, through 19, 2015 at the district's Tampa Service Office before Administrative Law Judge Bram Cantor. At the final hearing, respondents, petitioners, and interveners admitted exhibits into evidence and presented witness testimony. Members of the public were allowed to make comments at the final hearing. Following the hearing, a 5-volume transcript was produced and filed with DOA. The parties then submitted proposed recommended orders. On June 25th, 2015, Judge Cantor entered his recommended order. The ALJ found that the storm tech system met the district's design criteria for managing water quality and quantity, and all stormwater management requirements had been met. In regards to the wetland delineation, the ALJ found the petitioner's evidence was not sufficient to rebut land trust prima facie evidence on the issue. The ALJ agreed with respondents that the proposed retaining wall is not a vertical seawall as defined in the environmental research. Impacts resulting from scouring from the proposed retaining wall. Therefore, he determined the project did not meet the requirements related to unacceptable cumulative impacts and clearly in the public interest. Lastly, the ALJ found the applicant did not implement practical design modifications. Ultimately, the ALJ recommended the district issue a final order denying the ERP. On July 15th, the district and land trust each filed exceptions to the recommended order. On July 24th, the petitioners and interveners filed a joint response to respondents' exceptions to the recommended order, and on July 27th, they filed an amended joint response. And that concludes the factual and procedural history of this proceeding.
Thank you.
I just want to make a brief note about the oral arguments. As you know, each of the parties has been allotted a certain amount of time. We have Ms. Lori Manuel here who will be keeping time. As a note to the parties, as they are making their oral arguments, there are lights on the podium. The yellow light will go off when you have reached the mid oral argument time. We also have Ms. Amissa Smith, who is seated next to Ms. West, our general counsel, who will be holding up cards when you have reached the 10-minute, 5-minute, and 2-minute mark.
Good full screen. Yeah, just use the. No, I think it's. I'll do it. I think it's. Yeah, there you go. Thank you. Oh, no, you had it right. That's okay. Good. Thank you. Good morning. Thank you for the time. Let me just set my clock. Make sure I stay on my. I represent Land Trust 97, and I think you've heard previously some facts in the case. I try not to go through the same facts, but I just want to be able to go a little bit deeper in it. Initially, I want to tell you we reviewed the proposed order, the proposed final order by the district, and we support it fully. There are basically two issues that are outlined, at, I think, succinctly at paragraph 14 of the final order. The mitigation proposed by Land Trust is sufficient, and the reduction and elimination of the impacts to wetlands was adequately explored and considered. On those two things fall all of the exceptions that were filed by Land Trust. I first want to kind of familiarize you with the area. You've seen what I put up on the screen here, and you see when you hear discussion throughout the day, I just want you to have an idea of where these are located. This little exhibit locates the Tampa Bay Mitigation Bank. This is Land Trust. It's Land Trust Exhibit 16, page 4. And you also see the approximate limit the Tampa Bay Mitigation Bank has a service area that extends all the way down to the project area, which is Perico Island. You heard discussion here, and I'm indicating where the cursor, where that is. In addition to that, the Tampa Bay Basin, as we'll be talking about basins shortly, extends to within 3.5 miles of Perico Island, where the project is located. Also, if you look on this map, hopefully you've just been referencing the prior map, you'll see that this is Tampa Bay. This is Perico Island, and where I have the cursor down at the very bottom here, that's 64 heading across, and the project is just north of that along the western edge of Perico Island. Wanted to talk, we'll go through this a little bit more in the argument, but this finding, this exhibit is 1GGG, page 687. This is the boundary map for Land Trust 97, along with the wetland delineation. I put this up to show you two areas. There's only, you see the wetlands, these are the mangroves that have been discussed. And you see the project area up here, I know it's laying sideways, but north is to the top of the page there. This is the area where the project is located, in the very northern area up here. As you can see, that's the only piece of upland that's really available on the island. There's a small piece back here, but not large enough for any development. And we're talking about a four-home development with an associated driveway in the front of it. So there are very limited options on this piece of property. We heard discussion before about the using the roads. This the area just to the other side here is the development we talked about. And the roadways will be utilized and the utilities will all come through this development. And that was part of an agreement that's in the record as well between the two dealers to avoid having to run a road through the wetlands here to the project to create more damage. So going through those areas, we want to talk about the fact that there's an exterior mangrove fringe throughout the entire area here that will be maintained. As you can see from the prior exhibit that you saw that Mr. Tanner put up, this area in the green is the retaining wall. The yellow is a 2-foot elevation line. The other is the mean high water line, and that's at 1.33 feet. And there's a 2-foot line, and then the retaining wall in an area where there is lots, you see the four lots, is 35 feet from there. So there's a minimum of 40 feet of mangroves in front of the lots where there is wetlands. The idea is, even though there will be this internal area here, everything between this green line and the blue line will be filled, that's the 1.05 acres, there will still be mangroves on the external shore and in those areas. It's also interesting, I'm sorry, I want a good one. This is the exhibit 1II, page 718, this land trust exhibit. I do this, it's just simply to film you. I know this is a tough one, it's an engineer exhibit. But this is and you can see the scale down on the bottom. This is a cross section showing a 1 point on the retaining wall. And I put it up here just to show the elevation of the mean high water line, the 2-foot contour line, the retaining wall. The top of the retaining wall on the plans is at 6.25 feet. Now let me go into discussion of the arguments. And like I talked about before, there's only two really main arguments in this case. One is the sufficiency of mitigation. And as we've discussed, any determination of sufficiency of mitigation is within the final purview of the governing board. If you wonder why that is, there's two cases that are discussed. We've cited the same Anna Maria 700 Southern 2nd 116, but a predecessor case is cited by this case, 1800 Atlantic as well. The idea is in determining what mitigation is sufficient for the impacts. That brings in the unique capabilities of the board and on the 1800 case, the Department of Environmental Protection. You know, in past years, many years ago, there would be actual negotiations on what sufficient mitigation would be. And then the districts and the applicant would come to those terms and would set those out. And that was uniquely within the capabilities and the statutory discretion only of the department. It's not even, you can't even delegate it. 1800 is absolutely clear that that's an authority that you must hold on to. In that case, the DEP secretary went ahead and accepted the hearing officer's recommendations, changing the DEP's recommendations on mitigation. And the court said that was impermissible, that they actually cannot delegate that authority, that it must be held by the district as your final authority on all mitigation. Now, the interesting part of this case, although there are a number of exceptions that are challenged, They all fall, or the vast majority of them, under the sufficiency of mitigation, or as we talked about earlier, minimization. The sufficiency of mitigation, under your rules, if you don't have sufficient mitigation, then you cannot be fully offsetting your adverse impacts. If you're not fully offsetting your adverse impacts, then you would have to do a full-blown cumulative analysis. And that's where some confusion occurs. I wanted to take just a moment and point you to this, the statute 373.414 paren 8A, and just remind you that mitigation is, this is a strange thing to have to talk about, but there's some questions raised in the responses. Mitigation banks and mitigation banking are approved by statute. This is the law in the state of Florida. And the law specifies additionally that even if a mitigation bank is out of the basin, that those credits can still be used if certain criteria are met. And in this case, those criteria were met. I'd also point out that the Tampa Bay Mitigation Bank is the only mitigation bank whose service area extends to the project area. There was no other choice for the applicant. He couldn't go to another bank. One does not exist. I kind of set the tone a little bit on the first exception, then I promise I won't get into detail on the others. And this one's different than sufficiency of mitigation. It was exception 75. Now, if you'll bear with me, I'm going to read this one. I won't do that to you on the others. Although not acknowledged by the district, this is an unusual project. It resembles the kind of project that was common in the 1960s and 1970s in Florida. Before the enactment of environmental regulation, when high-quality wetlands were destroyed by dredging and filling to create land for residential development. In all reported DOH cases involving ERPs and mitigation of wetlands, the circumstances have involved impaired wetlands or restoration or permanent protection of other wetlands on project sites. No case could be found where an applicant simply paid for authorization to destroy almost an acre of high-quality wetlands and convert it to uplands. First of all, this is not a finding of fact. This is a conclusion of law. And second, this is quite clearly incorrect. And I think it shows the bias of the hearing officer in this proceeding. This is not an unusual project. The district issues many permits using mitigation banks for high quality wetlands. In addition, ALJ Bram Cantor actually had just issued an applicant a permit for another application for it was a road project and not a residential project to allow mitigation banking. The statutes are quite clear that mitigation banking is the acceptable and many times the preferred method for being able to make sure that regional mitigation banks are viable instead of planting small mitigation banks. When we used to do that, each shopping center would have an island with a wetland in the middle. Now the public policy was to go to a broader scheme and ensure that those would be there for in perpetuity. So when we move through those districts, through those information, through those cases, what we find is this is not an unusual project. Mitigation banking is the preferred way to mitigate in all developments in the state of Florida. And I believe in this particular case, it was the only methodology. There are many other mangrove wetlands on site. As we looked at the aerial map that you saw from the district, you saw that to the south, there's preserved mangroves in the Neal Preserve. It was pointed out in the hearing. That's just below where this development is across the 64. There's also the Robinson Preserve, which is to the east where those mangroves are preserved. So when we look in the area, there are many mangrove areas that are preserved. This is a wetland impact of 1.5 acres, and I believe you could avoid it. It was the only way to make the buildable lots according to the findings of fact. We could go through and talk about other issues that were involved, but I want to stick with this idea that fully offset, it's the key to this case. The judge found that there wasn't sufficient mitigation because even though he did not have competent substantial evidence on this issue, he determined that the UMAM score, which is the sole way to determine wetland impacts and mitigation amounts, that is your UMAM, that it was secondary impacts weren't accounted for properly, were not explained. The truth of the matter is, in the record, that there was no experts on wave action that provided testimony. In fact, no engineers testified for the petitioners at all. The only engineers are for the Water Management District of my client. And that the retaining wall is not set in an area where there'd be wave action, except during storm. So the issue is, what kind of impacts would there be? And I think you see in descriptions and the exceptions that both sides, both the district in their review and us in our review, we looked at the 0.85, the remainder of the mangroves that were in front of the retaining wall, and then secondary impacts determined there would not be more impacts than would be compensatable by the 0.09. So those were looked at, and it was described, and it's part of the UMAM process. And I understand the UMAM process is the sole way to determine these impacts. One of the confusing points of this case, I believe, for the hearing officer, is that the way to determine mitigation outside of the basin, when your mitigation bank, like this area, remember the service area extends, but it's outside of the Tampa Bay Basin. It's in the southern coastal basin. So in order to do that, you have to meet a different test. If you looked in your rules, I think we described it all in our findings, but it's 10.2, section 10.2.8, and the it goes through a process. If your mitigation was in the impact, within the basin rather, then you fully satisfy the criteria by providing enough mitigation, you're done. There is a second part to that test. If it's outside, but you showed connectivity, that is that your impacts in the area where they're located is connected to the place where the mitigation is going to be provided. We talk about this is all in Tampa Bay. If you show that connectivity, then you also can fully offset. And in this case, the judge found that we do have that connectivity in water, which includes hydrology and water quality, and in species. So he found that this was where our connectivity analysis was valid. He found that that was a more persuasive argument than the opponent's. And so this mitigation bank was sufficient or through the connectivity to be able to be utilized on site. Then the confusion began. He took a third part of the test, and this is a step one, you're in the basin. Step two, you're out of the basin, but you're connected. Then you're good to go. But then he added a third test, which is it is in the statute, but it's for banks where there isn't connectivity. When you have an issue where there isn't that connectivity, then you have to do what's called a full-blown cumulative test to go look at all development that would occur within your basin, the southern coastal basin. And if all that was mitigated for, you know, all future development, any kind of land use that would possibly occur, mitigated outside of the basin, then would there still be sufficient mangroves and other things that you need to be able to not have this adverse impact? That standard doesn't apply. That test doesn't apply. Once we solve the test in two, we're ready to go. Now, he may have applied that because of the earlier domino finding that there wasn't sufficient mitigation, so it wasn't fully offset. And that may have what led him to his determination, that he was incorrect in that determination and needs to be overruled, and your final order does them. The second thing that goes on, I'm talking about going on from connectivity, goes to the clearly in the public interest test. And again, I think those two fall in the findings, and these are exceptions 3 and 4. The findings are 51 and 77, 29, 30, and 31. But the issues were there. Since he found we didn't fully offset because he was rejecting the mitigation and the UMAM score, then what happened is he finds the cumulative impact is occurring. And therefore, you can't be clearly in the public interest with the cumulative interest, the cumulative impacts not being felt. And that's finding 1 and 51 and 77. Again, once you find there's sufficiency of mitigation, both of those, there's no cumulative impact then both of those findings would have to be turned into meeting it clearly in the public interest test. We have a standard in this case, which is somewhat unusual, in that if you're challenged and you're an applicant and you put in your prima facie case, talking more to the lawyers here, the hard part of this is there's a different standard. Once that prima facie evidence is in, they have to come back with equal or better quality evidence to overturn it. So understand the UMAM test was part of our prima facie case. It went into that record, but the record is completely devoid of any UMAM score that was properly done and received. The only UMAM score done by the opponents was by their witness, Ms. Cook, and it was found to be unreliable. So there isn't even competent substantial evidence, even if you had to go there, to be able to make that finding. And in fact, when we discussed this, and especially the scour issue, which was a secondary impact issue and erosion issue, Ms. Cook's analysis that she had turned in had done before we had put in a riprap on the other side, even though we believe this is out of the water, this rip and retaining wall is not in the water, but if there were a large enough storm, you know, the entire island would be covered with water. So there is a riprap wall that was put in front, just riprap in front of the retaining wall, and she didn't know that when she did her report. It hadn't been done yet. So when we deposed her, we asked her, And you agree that the addition of riprap added to the retaining wall will mitigate wave action and the concerns you had in your report, correct? Yes. So even their own witness agreed that that mitigated for those impacts. Now, the last thing we wanted to talk about is our finding on the issue of have you minimized sufficiently? And again, this is an issue in law where the hearing officer found all the facts we believe necessary to find in our favor, but he applied the standard, interpreted your rules incorrectly. So you don't have to create any new facts or strike any of the facts he stated, just simply interpret it by the proper district rule interpretation, which is given great deference. When we look at minimization, I point you to finding of fact number 25. In order to create buildable lots, 1.5 acres of 1.9 acres of mangrove on the project site would be removed and replaced with fill. A swath of mangroves 40 feet wide would remain waterward of the retaining wall. He said in order to create the buildable lots. And remember, we're talking about four homes here. It's not a massive development. And the idea is that through the minimization that was performed by us, by Land Trust, we've met the standard that the district has. This district standard isn't to do everything you possibly can do to minimize, because where would you ever stop? Could you shave another 4 inches? Could you shave another foot and a half? So the idea is we looked at the project, and going into the project, we went and found a way not to have to put a road or utility easements across that property where we'd have to fill the wetlands that you saw, the mangrove wetlands. We also found a way using the retaining wall, instead of having to slope the property from that 6.5 out at a 3-to-1, we put a retaining wall, which shortened that distance so that we were able to minimize those impacts that way. And the largest thing you talked about was the storm tech system. You know, we went from an above ground retaining pond to a below ground storm tech vault system under the road, which is more expensive, that eliminated that 30% of the wetland impact. So from 1.4 to 1.05. So we believe that we have met the minimization standard as applied by the district. We've made reasonable measures, we've made practical measures to be able to reduce the impacts for this four home development. In closing, what I'd like to say is there was a lot of time and effort spent by a lot of people on this project before it ever went in. You saw the time scales. The application was put in. It was a long series, a very large application is in the file. In addition to that, more changes and improvements were made during the hearing process, adding retaining wall being one of those. And when you look at what it takes to be able to build a four-unit development, be able to go find a mitigation bank whose service area extends to your project, be able to do a UMAM that's approved by and reviewed by the district, and be able to go then purchase and put on hold those mitigation banks, go to the storm tech system, all of those things to be able to make this development one that would reasonably work in the area with a minimal amount of environmental impact, we ask you to go forward and issue the proposed final order. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Chris Tanner, staff attorney of the Office of General Counsel. Myself and Marty Moore represented the district in this proceeding. I'll start by saying that the district supports the proposed final order and the ruling on the exceptions. The ALJ recommended that the district issue a final order denying the ERP, and he did so based on two issues. The first being the sufficiency of mitigation, specifically secondary impacts as resulting from scouring from the retaining wall, and second, reduction and elimination of impacts to wetlands. Now, because the judge found that the district undercalculated secondary impacts due to scouring, there were two other conditions of issuance that were affected, those being unacceptable cumulative impacts and clearly in the public interest. First, I'll address mitigation and then the related subjects of cumulative impacts and clearly in the public interest, and then I'll address reduction and elimination. So first, the sufficiency of mitigation, specifically secondary impacts. Finding of fact 30, the ALJ states, reliance on science is always appropriate. However, Mrs. Cook's use of the federal impact assessment methodology creates doubt about whether her scoring is consistent with UMAM. Despite the unreliability of Mrs. Cook's UMAM score, it is found that respondents' UMAM score undercalculated secondary impacts due to scour and other effects of changed water movement that would be caused by the retaining wall. And that's finding of fact 30. The district takes exception to finding fact 30 because there is no competent substantial evidence in the record to support this finding. Mrs. Cook was respondent's only expert to address mitigation in UMAM, and the judge found her testimony unreliable. And she found it unreliable because of the use of the federal impact assessment methodology. Statute 373.4118 states that UMAM is the sole methodology for determining mitigation. Ms. Cook even admitted that riprap would mitigate the wave action resulting from the retaining wall. Petitioner's expert, Mr. Steveley, and Mr. Johnson, the other two experts, did not address the sufficiency of mitigation or UMAM scoring. Secondly, courts have found that the district has the exclusive authority to determine the sufficiency of proposed mitigation. Therefore, since the district has the authority to determine the appropriateness of proposed mitigation, the district may treat this finding of fact as a conclusion of law that is not binding on the district. The district's conclusion of law that the mitigation is sufficient is based on competent, substantial evidence in the record and is more reasonable than the ALJ's conclusion of law. Cumulative impacts. This is in regards to finding of fact 46, 47, and conclusion of law 71 and 72. Applicant's Handbook, Volume 1, 10.2.8, provides three methods for addressing cumulative impacts depending on whether the proposed mitigation is within the same drainage basin as the adverse impacts, and two, whether the proposed mitigation fully offsets the adverse impacts within the impacted drainage basin. Paragraph 1 of 10.2.8 pertains to mitigation within the basin and is not applicable in this proceeding because the project area is in the south coastal drainage basin and the proposed mitigation is within the Tampa Bay drainage basin. Paragraph 2 is the spillover provision. It addresses a situation where the applicant has proposed mitigation physically located outside of the basin, but can demonstrate that the proposed mitigation fully offsets the adverse impacts within the impacted drainage basin based on such factors as the connectivity of water, hydrology, habitat range of affected species, and water quality. This situation is applicable because the proposed mitigation bank, the Tampa Bay Mitigation Bank, is outside the drainage basin of the impacts. Regarding the four factors, the ALJ found that the more persuasive evidence shows there is connectivity of waters near the project, there is connectivity of water between the waters near the project site and the waters of the Tampa Bay Mitigation Bank. Regarding habitat range, the ALJ found the species living in the mangroves at the project site are also found at the Tampa Bay Mitigation Bank. So why did the ALJ find the proposed mitigation did not fully offset adverse impacts and therefore result in unacceptable cumulative impacts? That is because the ALJ incorrectly found that secondary impact UMAM score undercalculated secondary impacts due to scouring by the installation of the retaining wall. If the functional loss associated with the proposed project does not equal the functional gain associated with the proposed mitigation bank, then the mitigation will not fully offset for the purposes of cumulative impacts. If the mitigation does not fully offset, then the applicant must pursue a paragraph 3 cumulative impact analysis that requires an analysis of the past, present, and future activities located within the drainage basin. It's this paragraph 3 analysis that the ALJ believed the applicant must complete. But as previously explained, there is not competent substantial evidence in the record to show that secondary impacts were undercalculated. and the district has the authority to determine the sufficiency of the proposed mitigation. Therefore, the proposed mitigation does fully offset adverse impacts, and the proposed project will have no unacceptable cumulative impacts upon wetlands within the impacted basin. The third issue connected to mitigation, clearly in the public interest. This is finding of fact 51 and conclusion of law 77. The district found that the project was clearly in the public interest because the proposed mitigation fully offsets the adverse impacts and because of the applicant's proposed public interest project. Again, because the ALJ found the proposed mitigation was not sufficient, he determined the project was not clearly in the public interest. And then we continue with the secondary impacts. There's no evidence in the record to support his determination, and the district has the authority to determine the sufficiency of the proposed mitigation. The last issue, reduction and elimination and practicable design modifications. This involves finding of fact 37, 38, and conclusion of law 68. The district takes exceptions to these finding of facts and conclusions of law regarding reduction and elimination because they are not supported by competent substantial evidence, and they are a misinterpretation of the district's rules on matters that squarely fall within the substantive jurisdiction and discretion of the district. Section 10.2.1.1 of the Applicant's Handbook Volume 1 provides, the agency, in determining whether to grant or deny a permit, shall consider whether the applicant has implemented practicable design modifications to reduce and eliminate adverse impacts. The ALJ stated that Land Trust did not demonstrate that it implemented reasonable design modifications to eliminate or reduce impacts to wetland functions, finding of fact 38. The file of record shows the applicant implemented practical design modifications, including using the StormTech underground chamber system rather than an above-ground retaining pond. They also used a retaining wall to reduce slope. And they also entered an agreement with the adjacent landowner to provide access to the project site rather than creating a new road. These design modifications resulted in a minimum reduced impact from the original 1.4 acres to 1.05, a reduction in 0.35 acres of impacts. Competent substantial evidence exists in the record demonstrating that Land Trust explored and implemented practicable design modifications to eliminate and reduce impacts to wetlands and other surface waters. Therefore, it is more reasonable to conclude that Land Trust explored and implemented practical design modifications to reduce impacts. In conclusion, the district supports the proposed final order and the ruling on exceptions to the recommended order. And I'll now ask to reserve the remainder of my time for rebuttal.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Ralph Brooks, and I'm an attorney. I was attorney for the city of Bradenton Beach, which is on Anna Maria Island, a little ways away from this project. I represent Sierra Club. Today I'm also speaking for Suncoast Waterkeeper, is also an important petitioner in this case. That's the Florida Institute for Saltwater Heritage, Inc. FISH. I don't know if you guys are familiar with FISH. Fish is in Cortez, which is very near this project. Fish is about commercial fishermen, people that rely on this water and rely on these mangroves for their livelihood. Fish puts their money where their mouth is. They're also doing wetland restoration projects. So they're very concerned about the loss of mangrove wetlands when they're actually doing things like mangrove restoration. If we could show the overhead. This shows you where Cortez is in relation to Perico Island and to the site in Anna Maria Sound. You saw this slide earlier. This shows the project area. The Swift Mud exhibit number one is the permit file. There's quite a lot in it, but I'm going to show you some additional drawings from the permit file. This shows you the project site. The property boundary for all the property owned by the applicant, which is bigger than this proposed project. They didn't include all their property in the project site. They have more property that they could develop that they've reserved for future development. They didn't say we're going to give this as a conservation easement. They didn't say we're going to do on-site mitigation. It includes this island out here. It's a very popular island for kayakers to kayak around and for people to recreate, to see birds and to do fishing. It also includes this area in here and this area to the north. You can see it on an aerial here. If we blow it up, you can see it even better. Of that bigger area, there certainly was room to do on-site mitigation. There's certainly room to put some conservation easement over this important intercoastal island, to do some mangrove restoration elsewhere on this project, besides going 17 miles away to Cockroach Bay Mitigation Bank. Here's an aerial of the project site with the four lots for four homes. Okay, what's unusual about this is how this retaining wall goes out so far. They need all that area behind the retaining wall to be filled. That means taking out all the native vegetation in the disturbed area, which is here. That's Australian pine. That's you know, buildable area now, but it could be restored. This area is on water and sewer. There's no reason why these can't be stilt homes. I've seen beautiful stilt homes on Holmes Beach, Bradenton Beach, and other areas where they have important native mangroves and wetlands. You don't have to fill it in. You can build on stilts and build above it. If we look at just the houses themselves don't take up that much area of the fill. In fact, here it shows you where they're filling the crosshatching, and with the houses overlaid, there's much more area to be filled to make backyards for these homes that are not necessary. This becomes important. Why is this case important for you? You've heard a lot of legal analysis. It's starting to sound like a courtroom in here. Perhaps it is, but I know it's very difficult. Most of you are not lawyers. Some of you are. I'd like to boil this case down to why it's important. One, it's located in outstanding Florida waters. It's an OFW. Okay, not all your permits are OFWs. It's on Anna Maria Sound on Perico Island near the important historic fishing village of Cortez. Okay, this is one of the last remaining true historic fishing villages, especially in Southwest Florida. There's a few others, but this one's special. It's a community. And this community has grown up around the mangroves.
I'm going to interpose an objection. The information about Cortez, I don't believe is relevant, isn't in your response to exceptions, and is not in the record.
I'll move on. It's also important because we're talking about the permanent destruction of the mangrove wetland fringe on Perico Island for what is a non-water dependent use for residential fill for four homes. This isn't for docks for the homes. This isn't for a marina that you have to have water. This is for four houses that have no docks. We're talking about a view. You can get a view by elevating up over the mangroves. It fails to reduce and eliminate an adverse impact because they want larger backyards. They haven't minimized that impact. And it fails to include any on-site mitigation where opportunities for on-site mitigation are clearly available, including the small island adjacent to Perico Island that's owned.
I'm going to object again. There is nothing in the record
that is
about
in the
using
record.
A small island as a mitigation area.
But I will move on.
I would
on,
actually
but that
like
is
to make a recommendation to the governing board that sustain Mr. Manson's objection. There has been quite a bit of discussion that exceeds the scope of the recommended order and the response to the exceptions that were filed jointly by the petitioners and interveners.
Okay, so we'll rule
okay,
sustain.
I'll move
Thank
on.
You.
The administrative law judge, after listening to 3 days of testimony and 5 volumes of transcripts, I doubt that all of you have read all 5 volumes of transcripts. It's 3 days worth of time. And even just to read the volumes of transcripts takes a good part of a day, much less look at all the volumes and volumes of exhibits that took up a couple of tables. The ALJ found that local Fish and Wildlife, local biologic electrical productivity would be diminished by the proposed project. That's important to petitioners. The proposed project will be of a permanent nature, will adversely affect fishing, recreation values, and marine productivity in the vicinity of the project. This light, how much time does that light mean I have? Is that, I'm still okay, right?
13 minutes.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay. So we sat for 3 days. We have 5 volumes of transcripts. We have numerous exhibits. This is not the way it's supposed to work. We're not supposed to go there, put on our case, get our findings of fact found, have the administrative law judge recommend that this permit be denied, and have the whole thing overturned when we come to the governing board that hasn't heard all the evidence, hasn't seen the experts live. And we had a former Marine Extension agent there, John Steveley, talking.
I'm sorry, I'm going to step in at this moment and recommend that the governing board object to this line of oral argument. This, again, exceeds the scope of the recommended order. It also exceeds the scope of the joint response to the exceptions filed by the petitioners and interveners, and also is not in compliance with the law and the responsibilities that the governing board has today.
Okay, I'll move on, but I believe it is part of the record, and John did testify. I believe I am able to talk about anything in the record, but we'll save that for appeal. Van versus Schmidt, a case, Florida Supreme Court, 2013, says, and it was about an administrative law judge's recommended orders, findings of fact, and determinations of credibility are entitled to deference because of his superior vantage point of having been present during the entire trial. So it's difficult for even you to rule on these objections because you weren't there, you're not sure what happened. The factual issues susceptible of ordinary methods of proof are within the prerogative of the administrative law judge. And that goes all the way back to McDonald in 1977 and the Heifetz case in 1985. In Save Anna Maria, the case they're relying on, the administrative law judge knows about that case. He cited it in his recommended order. Both the recommended order and the final order in that case denied the permit. So it didn't make much difference about whether or not the mitigation was within the purview or not, they denied it. Just like in this case, it doesn't make much difference because the administrative law judge also found that this project was not clearly in the public interest. He also found that adverse impacts weren't reduced or minimized. The legislature, the Florida legislature, does not like it when you overrule findings of fact. It states in 120.595, if the court, the appellate court, finds that the agency improperly rejected or modified findings of fact in a recommended order, the court shall award reasonable attorney's fees and reasonable costs to a prevailing appellant for the administrative proceeding and the appellate proceeding. That's fees from the 3 days, the administrative proceeding and the appellate proceeding. You're highly discouraged from overturning findings of fact. The findings of fact, based on competent substantial evidence that you are not at liberty to overrule, include the following. That these are high quality mangroves. They're mostly black and red mangroves with some white mangroves. That the mangroves have high biological productivity and are important to the estuarine food web. That the mangroves provide nesting, roosting, foraging, and nursery functions for species of wildlife. That mangroves also provide a buffer for storm surge and help stabilize shorelines. And there's wildlife species found in this site. That the applicant proposes to remove 1.05 acres of the 1.9 acres of mangroves that are on the project site and replace them permanently with fill. That they talk about the slope of the waterward side of the fill area. But this proposition assumes the appropriateness of the size of the fill area. And you'll remember this final slide. Is it appropriate for the applicant to have this much fill area behind the area that they need for houses? It's simply too much. Finding a fact, the proposed project would cause fewer impacts to wetlands if the fill area was reduced in size, which was not shown to be impracticable. Reducing the size of the fill area would not cause the project to be significantly different in type or function.
that the land trust could propose a similar project on another part of its property on Perico Island, and they could apply to enlarge buildable portions of that property by removing wetlands and filling behind a retaining wall. When you consider that, that they could have cumulative impacts from similar future activities on their own parcels, not to mention nearby parcels on Anna Maria Sound. We're looking at cumulative impacts of the proposed project would result in significant adverse impacts to wetland functions in the area. That means other people can do it. If you grant this, other people can do this. And that's why they're worried about cumulative substantial impacts. Finally, he finds that the project is not clearly in the public interest because of adverse impacts to the conservation of fish and wildlife, fishing and recreation values, and marine productivity of Anna Maria Sound and outstanding Florida water. In summary, we would ask you to uphold the judge. We had 3 days of testimony. We had, I don't know how many witnesses. We had 5 volumes of transcripts, countless exhibits. This was all weighed. He's making a recommendation to you as an independent agency of the state of Florida Division of Administrative Hearings. That's why we set up this process, to go there and try the case. We have more than 20 minutes. We have as much time as we need. There's discovery, there's depositions. Everyone knows what's going on. We shouldn't sit here as a governing board that hasn't heard all that and second guess what the administrative law judge is recommending. Very easily deny this application. They can come back with a revised application. They can reduce the size of the fill in the backyards like the judge has recommended. They could even put these homes on stilts. They could do on-site mitigation on that island. Remove Australian pines, replace them with mangroves. They could do other on-site stuff. We don't have to approve this permit as is, and that's what the judge recommended. Thank you.
I'll go ahead and start this way. I don't waste your time.
You have 6 minutes and 50 seconds remaining.
Good morning. My name is Joseph McClash, and I am one of the petitioners in these hearings. I'm also the qualified representative for FISH and Minnesota 88, an environmental organization. I'd just like to give a little bit of perspective of what's in front of you as a petitioner. I fought the giant. The developer has more resources. This district has our tax dollars to defend their action. But we went to a third party, unbiased, looked at the evidence, came to a conclusion of law based on findings of fact that are not supposed to be overturned if there's one shred of fact in that record. And there are plenty of facts to uphold the administrative law judge's order. Modifications, you heard Attorney Brooks talk about why are the backyards so large? These are all things that came out in a hearing, and a judge determined that you can modify this even further not to impact the wetlands, and that the applicant didn't go far enough. That's a fact. It's not a conclusion of law, a sufficiency of mitigation. The UMAM score is not accurate. Neither ours or theirs was found by the judge to be accurate. That's a fact. We're not determining the sufficiency of mitigation. The judge even put a clause in there. It's up to you to determine that. But common sense should prevail. If you have the removal of 1 acre of mangroves along a shoreline that buffers it from wave action, and you're trying to mitigate 17 miles away in another county, does that mitigate for storm impacts that you should be concerned about? I would say not. So when you look at the summary of what the trust and your own district attorney brings forward, it's saying you don't have to worry about clearly in the public interest and meeting all that recreational value impact test that the judge found you did not meet as an applicant. All you have to worry about is the math score. Here's the UMAM score, which there is no fact that it's accurate. And you have a mitigation bank that says you could go there and you could impact the local area. You're supposed to be protecting us. I'm a fisherman, a boater, a kayaker. I love this area. I served 22 years as a county commissioner, and I protected the environment when I was there. Very proud of it. longest-serving member of the Tampa Bay National Estuary Policy Board. We joined together historically with all these environmental organizations for the first time in our county, I believe, to say, draw the line in the sand here. It's up to you. Very easy decision. Accept the recommended order from the administrative law judge, because it's the right thing to do. If you were in our shoes and you fought this battle, would you think it's fair to change the facts by the same governing board that was going to issue the permit that the administrative law judge said you should deny? And along the way, just for information, it's part of the record, they didn't do a cumulative impact analysis for that mitigation bank that was later determined needed after the petition was filed. The seawall didn't have riprap in front of it. It was a vertical, it was a seawall, which isn't allowed in estuaries, which they put the riprap in after the petition was filed. So we made a little bit of progress with getting things modified, but it's still not good enough. So we're really looking for you to do what's the right thing. Follow your rules. You have an administrative handbook, volume one. 10 point whatever it is that has most of these sections. Why have all those criteria to meet for recreational values and public interest tests if you're going to allow an argument to take place that says, we have a UMAM score and you should use that, mitigate in Tampa, another county, forget about the impacts to the storm from storm surges, and Cortez, the fishing village, the community that uses the shorelines. You know, this has a real big impact on how do we develop the next project in Sarasota Bay, Palmasola Bay, Terracea. Is it your policy that you're going to allow the removal of wetlands to build houses? Is that in the public interest when you have other choices to make? There's other lots available. These aren't the only four lots left. And there's no mandate that just because somebody came forward with four lots that you have to give them permission to build four lots. That's absurd. We have a lot of threats to the environment in Manatee County. Why? Because we had great policies to preserve our shorelines, great comprehensive policies that some people are challenging. And it's unfortunate that we get challenged on policies that are based on science. We're not coming to you because we're whacked out environmentalists that don't have the science behind us. Mangroves serve as a very important part of our economic reasons that we're successful here. You know, when you see kayakers paddling by these natural shorelines, you want to replace them with seawalls? I mean, there's a place for things to take place, such as residential homes. They don't have to be removing mangroves to have homes today. So really, is it worth removing an acre? 50% of the mangroves approximately would have to be removed from this site. Is that the precedent? It's okay to remove 50% of the mangroves? You have a tough decision, but I think it's an easy one. And I implore you to accept the administrative law judge's recommendation of denial. Let them come back and resubmit.
Doug Manson again. I just want to be clear, there is no seawall.
Mr. Manson, you have approximately 1 minute that you had from your prior oral argument. I just wanted
I'll
to
be
make
fine
note
with the
that.
10 minutes. I won't go that long. So, you know, initially, let's talk about there isn't a seawall on site. There's a retaining wall. And the reason for it was to hold back the area to be able to shorten that extension into the wetland. Second, you know, I don't interpret that ALJ's order to say that you can't mitigate outside of the basin. And the reason I don't do that is because if you go to the transcript, and this is in my exceptions at page 8, and in the transcript at 569 through 71, the ALJ was discussing this. And at the finally, I'll read this, but at the end, what he says is, now there can be mitigation in another place. That's part of the law, and he recognizes that. Says there's a mitigation allowed by statute, this is quoting him, and there's even, I mean, a fairly lengthy statutory provision for it. So it's a sanctioned idea. It means that there are some local losses from the critter's point of view, a raccoon's point of view, a crab's point of view, a fish's point of view, and that mitigation on the face of it says those wetlands, if you satisfy mitigation, don't have to be there anymore. It's their starting place. Now they can be mitigated for in another place. And that's what the applicant did here. He went to the only available mitigation bank to find his credits to be able to purchase it. He performed a unit analysis. He provided that analysis with a superior amount of evidence than the petitioners did, and the district accepted that analysis. There's been a lot of discussion about potential future projects on the property. I'm reading for Land Trust Exhibit 1AAA. This is the form on the application. It's a standard question. Is it a part of a larger plan of development or sale? And there's a yes, no. Land Trust checks no. This is the development for that property. And that's more than the 3.46 acres. There's 5 acres of mangroves existing to the north and the south. There's 0.85 acres of mangroves, like I said, waterward of the retaining wall. So we have not destroyed the mangrove fringe. It still exists. And to go back onto this issue of minimization, your rules don't require that you do anything possible to be able to mitigate. Stilt houses are not practical. They know that. There's an agreement with the adjacent developer that in part gave us the ability to do the road that also requires that the homes look similar to the style of the homes that are on the adjacent development, which are not stilt homes. So the idea is there was not that requirement. It's not mandated that we look at every single way we can do it. We mitigated, we minimized, and we squeezed those four houses into as little space as it could be done for the location. Remember, it's not just houses there. We also have to have a road. We have to have a 25-foot setback from the other development, and we have to, the stormwater stuff is under the roads. We shrank that space, and then you've got the homes. So at that, if you have any questions, I'll be glad to address them. If not, I thank you for your attention.
Any discussion from the board? All right, thank you.
In regards to the sufficiency of mitigation, again, our argument is that there is no competent substantial evidence in the record to support the ALJ's finding that the district undercalculated secondary impacts due to scouring. And as you just heard from the petitioners and interveners who did not mention any substantive competent evidence to support the ALJ's finding of fact, and that's because there is not anything in the record to support that determination.
We object to that statement.
Ms. Amy?
We cited to it in the response, the written response.
Okay.
It was in the...
I had a hard time hearing the objection.
We object to it because it was part of the record and the responses.
The written response to the exceptions talk about the scouring testimony.
I would rule that you overrule that objection. The scope of these oral arguments is with respect to the exceptions filed and the oral arguments.
Agree. Go.
There's also discussion about mitigation taking place in another county, and there were opportunities for on-site mitigation. There's nothing in rule or statute that provides a preference for mitigation. The district's responsibility is to evaluate the mitigation as proposed by the applicant. In this case, the applicant proposed providing mitigation through purchasing 0.9 forested credits from the Tampa Bay Mitigation Bank. The district feels that, you know, again, that this proceeding comes down to the two issues, the sufficiency of mitigation, and there's not anything in the record to support the ALJ's conclusion, and secondly, the reduction in elimination. And the district feels that the ALJ misinterpreted the rules regarding reduction in elimination, and that sufficient and practicable design modifications were provided by the applicant to meet that condition of issuance.
Thank you. Any questions from the board? All right, thank you.
So the portion of today's presentation dealing with the oral arguments is now concluded, and I would recommend that the board consider entertaining a 5-minute recess between the oral arguments and my presentation concerning the proposed final order. That part of the presentation has the potential to be lengthy, so I would recommend that we entertain a 5-minute recess.
So move 5-minute break. Be back here at 5 minutes. Can do the math real quick. All right, everyone can have a seat. We'll resume. Ms. Brennan, please take us home.
Good morning again. Amy Brennan from the Office of General Counsel. At this point, I am going to quickly walk the governing board back through what it is poised to do momentarily, which is enter a final order in the proceeding. Again, as a reminder, the governing board may either adopt the ALJ's recommended order in total, or it may reject or modify findings of fact and conclusions of law contained in the ALJ's order. And again, there are different standards for doing each of those things at your leisure or at your option. With respect to findings of fact, you may not reject or modify findings of fact unless you determined after a review of the entire record that the findings of fact were not based on competent substantial evidence or that the proceedings did not comply with the essential requirements of law. All of you have been provided with a copy of the record, and I know that you have reviewed it, as well as the supporting materials to the final order. With respect to findings of fact, remember I told you earlier this morning that there is an important exception to the relevant standard, which was outlined in the Save Anna Maria case, which provides that the permitting agency has the authority to determine the sufficiency of the proposed mitigation, and an ALJ's findings related to mitigation can be treated like conclusions of law, and that standard can be applied thereto. And I will remind you of the standard for conclusions of law momentarily. And that is, you may reject or modify an ALJ's conclusion of law and or their application of policy so long as you make a finding that your substituted conclusion is as or more reasonable than that which was rejected or modified. In making such a finding, you may apply your experience, expertise, and policy. So as I mentioned earlier, you were provided in advance of this meeting some materials in support of the proposed final order. Those included a copy of the proposed final order, the recommended order, which is Exhibit A, land trust exceptions to the recommended order, which is Exhibit B, the district's exceptions to the recommended order, which was Exhibit C, petitioners and interveners' joint amended response to the exceptions, which was Exhibit D, the proposed ruling on those exceptions, which is Exhibit E, and the proposed ERP number 430-41746, which is Exhibit F. You were also provided a copy of the hearing record, which included the transcripts, the exhibits filed in the hearing, and all the recommended order and all of the post-hearing filings. There has been one change to the recommended ruling concerning conclusion of law number 74, and that was contained in Exhibit E, the proposed ruling on exceptions. That change was provided to the parties via official correspondence yesterday. An updated ruling on exceptions has been placed at each of your chairs, and I will walk you through that proposed ruling now. So if you could please turn to page 5 of proposed Exhibit E, the ruling on the exceptions. This deals with conclusion of law number 74. And again, because this is a conclusion of law, the district here must make a finding if it substitutes or rejects this conclusion that its substitution or rejection is as or more reasonable than the ALJ's conclusion. Paragraph 74 states that the district rules state that protection of wetlands and other surface waters is preferred to destruction and mitigation. The proposed permit does not reflect that preference. While the first sentence is generally accurate, a portion of the rule language has not been included in this conclusion of law. Section 10.2.1 of the applicant's handbook requires an applicant to explore practicable design modifications to reduce and eliminate impacts, and Section 10.2.1.1 of the applicant's handbook requires the district to consider whether the applicant has done so. The applicant's handbook does not require that the permit reflect a preference, but rather sets out the process by which practicable design modifications to reduce or eliminate adverse impacts are to be considered and explored. Section 10.2.1 then states that adverse impacts remaining after practicable design modifications have been made may be offset by appropriate mitigation. Therefore, it is more reasonable to substitute a more accurate restatement of Section 10.2.1 of the applicant's handbook. Therefore, it is recommended that you accept in part and reject in part the exception and modify conclusion of law number 74 as follows. To state, in accordance with the provisions of section 10.2.1 of the applicant's handbook, volume 1, protection of wetlands and other surface waters is preferred to destruction and mitigation. Design modifications to reduce or eliminate impacts must be explored and considered. Mitigation is required to offset the adverse impacts remaining after practicable design modifications have been made. So I'm going to present to you a summary of the proposed rulings that are contained in Exhibit E. Generally, those proposed rulings find that the mitigation proposed by the applicant was sufficient, and that reduction and elimination of impacts to wetlands and other surface waters was adequately explored and considered. Therefore, all of the ALJ's findings and conclusions in the recommended order, which led to the determination that the permit should be denied, have been overcome, which led to my ultimate recommendation that the governing board adopt the proposed final order and issue ERP number 430-41746 to the applicant. Now, I have prepared approximately 80 to 90 additional slides that I can walk the governing board through regarding each of the proposed rulings on each of the exceptions, and I can do so at your leisure. Alternatively, I would be happy to entertain any specific comments that you might have or questions that you might have regarding the proposed rulings that you have reviewed.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Mr. Senth.
Amy, could you enlighten, clarify, or say whatever your position is. I'm familiar somewhat with the process of getting a mitigation bank certified and approved, and I'm sure the applicant has used a certified mitigation bank. Did the judge or anyone in the process consider the use, it was thrown around rather casually, that you could mitigate on site, but isn't a mitigation bank that's certified preferred and the people better served by having a certified mitigation bank than just casually trying to throw mitigation together on site?
Yes. When I proposed my ruling to conclusion of law number 75, and if you would indulge me for a moment, I will move forward in my presentation so that I can get to that. So remember, conclusion of law 75 was discussed earlier today. It is the one that found that this was an unusual project. There is ample statutory and rule support for the use of mitigation banks as appropriate mitigation. And if you would mind, I'd like to walk you through some of those relevant statutory and rule provisions. Specifically, section 373.414 allows an applicant to either propose on-site mitigation, off-site regional mitigation, or the purchase of mitigation bank credits. Section 373.4135 directs the water management districts to participate in and encourage the use of off-site mitigation and mitigation banking, providing in pertinent part that mitigation banks and off-site regional mitigation can enhance the certainty of mitigation and provide ecological value due to the improved likelihood of environmental success associated with their proper construction, maintenance, and management. Therefore, we are directed to participate in and encourage the establishment of private and public mitigation banks and off-site regional mitigation. Furthermore, section 373.4135 directs that mitigation banks and off-site regional mitigation be considered appropriate and a permittable mitigation option under the conditions of the Water Management District rules. And our Water Management District rules specifically provide that the purchase of mitigation banks are an accepted and appropriate form of mitigation to offset wetland impacts.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions that I could entertain for you? So at this time, I'll repeat my recommendation, which is to adopt the proposed final order and issue ERP number 430-41746 to Land Trust number 9712.
All right. Any discussion, any other further questions from the board? Do we entertain a motion?
So moved.
Second.
I'll read please, Mr. Bruff, read the recommendation, please, for your motion.
Adopt the proposed final order and issue ERP number
43041746.000, the land trust number 97-12.
We have a motion, we have a second. Is there any more discussion from the board? All right, we will now call a vote. All in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Aye.
All opposed?
Nay.
One nay. The motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Dunbar, now we'll get back on to regularly scheduled time. We're now relinquished to Mr. Dunbar for finance.
Finance, Outreach, and Planning Committee together. There were no consent items moved for discussion, no items to be taken before the committee. Routine reports were filed, pages 255 through 280. There are no questions. Finance, Outreach, and Planning Committee is adjourned. Relinquish the gavel to Mr. Moran.
I'd like to call to order the Regulation Committee of the Southwest Florida Water Management District dated August 25th, 2015. We did have a consent item moved for discussion, which was 5D, but it was already voted on and approved unanimously. There are no denials referred to the Governing Board this month. Submit and file reports, we have none. We do have two routine reports, which are items 37 and 38 in your packet. Any questions on the routine reports? Seeing none, the Regulation Committee will stand adjourned. I'll pass the gavel to Mr. Maggard.
We now open operation and lands, and we had no consent items moved. We now move into Mr. Kinsman, which is going to tell us that it's raining somewhere. It's raining somewhere.
Sure, it's raining somewhere.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, members of the board. Yes, we've had a lot of rain and a lot of things to talk about how it's impacted our water resources. So let's start. This is rainfall for July, and that's the beginning of the event. It started in July 24th and ended in August 3rd, and it delivered a tremendous amount of rainfall in a very defined area. You can see for the month, we had about 11 inches. Normal is only 8 inches, or is 8 inches. You can see where the majority of the rain fell along the coast. And you can see that there were some areas that didn't get much rainfall over in Polk County, only about 3 inches over there in one area. When you look at that event, and we looked at it for various intervals to determine the magnitude of the rainfall, and this was probably the strongest signal we saw. On a 30-day interval, the area in southwestern Pasco County, around Elfers, around Newport Richey, actually exceeded a 500-year event. Yeah. So it was an extraordinary amount of rainfall. It was about 27 inches for that event in that area. When you look at 12-month totals, you add in last month, you can see that this area of above normal rainfall, above weather than normal conditions, extends into a larger area. And however, you don't see a lot of change over in the Peace River Basin. But you also see that the Newport Richey area,
Mr.
has
Kinsman.
Received. Yes,
sorry, just a quick question.
Yes.
What in a 12-month period? What is our average rainfall in Florida? 52 inches.
It's 53. Yeah, 53. Exactly.
Okay.
That's correct.
So, just so, yes. Just wanted to be clear.
Yeah, yeah, this is.
I'm losing it.
That's for sorry. The year.
Yeah, right.
7 months.
Yeah.
Go back so one slide. Did you say that the rainfall in the pink there is mm-hmm.
500. It exceeds the 500-year event.
Boy, that's a tough one to plan for, Mark.
I don't understand what you guys. You guys are dropping the ball.
I mean, come on.
We had our portable pumps out there, though.
That's true. We did. Yes, we did. Thank you for reminding me. Please continue.
Thank you. But you can see almost 86 inches, and that's a tremendous amount of rain in a one-year period. When you look at 12-month departure from mean, you can see that with that rainfall from last month, we're about 2.6 inches over the long-term mean district-wide. And you add in the rainfall that we received to date this month, it goes above normal, about a 5-inch surplus for the 12-month period. This is rainfall we've received through Monday morning. And we continue to get rain in August, and you can see 19 inches in Tampa. But you see there's also quite a few areas where we haven't really received a lot of rainfall. But once again, the rain that is falling in the same area that was impacted from the previous events. And if I could go back one, I just want to make another point. If you look here, you see this is essentially pre-event. These areas were wet to begin with, and that's one of the reasons that this was made a little bit worse than even, you know, just the rainfall. So the areas were wet to begin with, we get the extraordinary rain, and you have a lot of problems. So to date, we have about 8.8 inches, and 8 is normal. So this has impacted all of our water resources. This is groundwater in the north. You can see the sharp increase. It's actually at the base of, or at the top of the normal range. Groundwater in the central county is above normal. And after this event, we actually had 19 wells that were at a period of record highs for that specific week. Now it's dropped down to about 9 for this week, but still the impact continues to be shown. This is groundwater in the southern counties, still with normal, but showing an increase. Lakes made rather large jumps district-wide, particularly in the central region. And this is actually, this part right here is actually what was what happened in July. Red is what's happened in August. So we're continuing to see improvements or rises in water levels. And you can see that water levels now are at levels that were last seen in 2005. Tampa Bay Lakes haven't changed much this month on average. However, you see the large jump last month. And you see it's up the upper range of normal at this point. And just some interesting things. In Pasco and Hillsborough counties, 22 of the 121 lakes with long-term record reached new period of record highs after this event. 8 lakes had in excess of 60 years of record. And 5 of those were last observed in the 1940s to 60s. And then Lake Keystone crested by the high water level observed during Hurricane Donna. So just extraordinary changes in some of the lakes in the region that was affected. Polk Upland Lakes also rose sharply. If you go from here to there, you can see it's a big change in the past 2 months. And Lake Wales Ridge Lakes are the base of the normal range on average. Last time, that was 10 years ago. So the Withlacoochee River, once again, this is an 8-week average, so it doesn't reflect the current conditions out there, but you see the increase. Currently, the flow out there is about the 50th percentile. Hillsborough River is actually about 90th percentile, but showing sharp increases. The reservoir is full, of course. Alifier River showing sharp increases. Once again, that's also at the 90th percentile today. The reservoir is full. They're operating at that. Peace River, once again, is also currently at the 90th percentile, the 8-week mean jumping. And reservoir, the public supply from Peace is, I believe this is about as high as I've ever seen it, about 11.5 billion gallons available. They've got 5 billion gallons in the ASR at this point. The climate forecast, this is the latest, and this is saying September may be below normal in rainfall, and that may not be a bad thing for some of these, for some areas. It's, I think, the first time I ever said that.
Yeah. First time in 6 years.
But particularly given the later forecast for this year, above normal temperatures, the 3 week, or excuse me, the 3 month forecast, they're shifting back to normal for normal rainfall predictions through October, November. Once again, staying above normal temperatures. And then you get into the El Nino forecast that I've been showing you. And if you notice that the December through February, actually December through April, it's a very, very dark green. And that's basically the expectations are very, very strong that we will have above normal rainfall during that period. Temperatures, as I mentioned before, with the El Nino events tend to be below normal. And the hurricane in the Atlantic hurricane season is picking up a bit. Daniel has dissipated, and I think this is what's left of it. Erica is strengthening. Current forecast as of 11 o'clock seemed to indicate it recurving back out into the Atlantic. I certainly hope that's the case, but we'll keep an eye on that. In summary, you know, extreme rainfall was really aggravated by pre-existing conditions in those areas that were already wet. As I mentioned, the tropical storm season is becoming active. Should we get, we don't necessarily have to have a storm. It just, the moisture from a storm that dissipates could come across us and add to the potential rainfall. And our winter and spring forecast is calling for above normal rainfall and cool temperatures. Now, Jason Hopp is going to follow me and talk about district operations in response to this rainfall. So I'd like to end with this this graphic. This is rainfall from July 1st through yesterday. Excuse me, I think through Sunday. And you see the rainfall extends well beyond that event that we had. And if you look over in this impacted area over near Newport Richey, we've had almost 40 inches of rain, when 53 is what we expect in a year. And that's in less than 2 months. So, and it really extends well beyond that over into the Tampa area and the Bypass Canal and that whole system and the lakes areas. So with that, I'll pass it over to, if you have any questions before I pass it to Jason.
Any questions? Thank you.
Thank you. Granville.
Good morning, members of the board. For the record, I'm Jason Hopp, Operations and Land Management Bureau Chief. And as Granville mentioned, I'll be talking about the district's response to the recent extensive rain and flooding. Just some event facts. This prolonged rain event began on July 24th, resulting in severe flooding in Hillsborough, Pasco, and Pinellas counties. And as a result of this, all three of those counties activated their emergency operation centers. On August 6th, the governor declared a state of emergency for Hillsborough, Pasco, Pinellas, Taylor, and Dixie counties. And subsequently, the district EOC activated to a level 2 or a partial activation so we could start capturing all the cost of the event in case there is a federal declaration. The district staff have logged over 3,500 hours responding to this event through aid to counties and cities, operations of structure, of structures on 24/7 basis, issuing 21 emergency field authorizations, providing stakeholders with floodplain and data modeling, and collecting high water data across the district. We also responded to and documented over 350 flooding complaints, and we handled numerous media requests. So once the magnitude of the storm was realized, we reached out to our affected cities and counties to offer assistance. Our ED even went out and toured many of the impacted areas with public officials. Starting on July 29th, the district assisted Pasco County with equipment and staff and provided two district pumps and procured an additional 7 pumps from our sister agencies in South Florida and St. John's. We also provided a sandbagger machine, 100 cubic yards of sand, and staff to assist with the bagging operations. And over the past 3 weeks, we distributed about 7,000 bags of sand. Our fleet maintenance staff also was very valuable as well, because they performed daily inspections and maintenance on all the loaned equipment. So they were out in the field every day, checking this equipment during the weekends and everything. So there was a lot of staff time and effort put into this. In addition, our engineering staff supported the Pasco County EOC for about 60 hours worth of time, and they were helping them with floodplain management issues. They also responded to data and modeling requests from numerous other local governments as well. Our structure operations crew was also very busy over this period. They logged over 1,100 hours in this 3.5-4 week period, maintaining and operating structures to assist with flood protection. In close coordination with the City of Tampa and Tampa Bay Water, we activated the Lower Hillsborough Flood Detention Area and the Tampa Bypass Canal for the first time since the hurricanes in 2004. This activation helps prevent flooding on the Hillsborough River and the Temple Terrace in Tampa area. The district also operated water conservation structures on 12 lakes in the affected counties in Hillsborough and Pinellas. And as Granville mentioned, many of the lakes exceeded the highest period of record. And four of these that we operate that occurred on Lake Pretty, Lake Armistead, Lake Keystone, and Lake Crescent. Our staff also began working 24/7 from August 3rd all the way through August 23rd in order to operate the TVC and relieve our structure controls analyst, who was working 16 to 20 hours a day prior to that, and we had to relieve him. I knew I had to do something when he showed up to work with a pillow and a blanket. So our field staff stepped up and they worked through the night operating structures to give him some rest. As a result of the high levels and flows that we experienced, we did suffer some minor damage to some of our structures on the Tampa Bypass Canal, as well as our Lake Pretty structure. It was minor damage that the repairs have been made. We will still have to do some more repairs once the water recedes, but they are in good condition right now. And our staff also received about 50 complaint calls regarding the operations of the lakes. And in response to that, we plan on meeting with numerous homeowners associations to discuss our lake operational guidelines in the coming months. They seem to want a good understanding of how we operate our lakes, and it should be very good for the public. And that's all I have in regards to that. I have a couple pictures I'd like to show you just to illustrate how intense this flooding was in some of our areas. This is our Lake Pretty structure right here. This structure was opened well ahead of the storm, and it's opened here, but you can't tell because it's about 3 foot over the top of it. We've never seen conditions like this before. It was completely overtaken by events, and there was no control at this point. It was just a matter of letting nature take its course. This is another picture from the side there. You can see that the bank completely washed out, and the whole wetland area around there is just completely inundated. And this was one of the lakes that also exceeded the period of record. This is our Lake Armistead structure. Same thing here. You can see the water almost made it up to our actuators, which moved the gates. And you can see that area right in the front there is our catwalk that we normally walk to the structure on, and it looks like it's about 2.5-3 feet underwater. So this structure was completely overtaken as well, and was also opened quite some time ahead of the event. And this is another picture surrounding the structure and where the water was getting up into the yards and close to some of the facilities. That's all I have. Any questions?
Mr. Beltran. Thank you. I just wanted to take a second and just thank staff for all the hard work they've done. There's no doubt that we've had, as we continue to face our challenges with transition and baby boomers retiring and transition of staff, we really did have some great leadership step up from the district. Jason did a great job leading the operations group. Diane Kuntz, our new structures manager, did a great job. And Mike Bartlett, who's in the audience here, really showed some of that experience and wisdom over the years of operating these structures and going that extra mile to making sure that we did everything we possibly could to help respond to this event. So I just want to take a second and thank everybody, whether it's the operation crews that are out there making things happen, or it's the scientists and engineers managing the emergency operations centers, or it's the regulation staff out there working with local governments to make sure that when they are pumping and how they are pumping is adequate and appropriate, not to flood downstream residents. So again, I just want to take a second to thank everybody on that. I think we really have stepped up to the plate as an organization.
Thank you, Mr. Bruce.
Mr. Chair, I'd just like to say that as the original mission that the Water Management District was created for, it's always a proud moment to see the amount of, because you go so far beyond. When you start working nights and through the morning hours and stuff, that's what the public expects from us, but you guys do it really great, and I certainly appreciate this effort because it reduces the tension that some of these poor people are feeling when their houses are getting close to flooding, and at least they know we're out there and we care, because we do. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
I'd like to add on to that. I also want to thank our sister, our comrades, in helping us with the pumps. So please pass our regards to that. And also to staff going out in the middle of the night grabbing these pumps and for the call. And I want to thank you. It is a devastating thing. We all don't like it, but I do appreciate how staff handled it. And I think y'all are very professional, and I appreciate that. It made the calls I had a lot more bearable, I can tell you that. So thank you very much. Any more comments? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Submit file reports. Any questions on 41? If not, routine reports are there in page 303 and 306. Any comments, questions? If not, operations land is closed. I will now move to committee liaison reports. Paul Senth, number 44. Any comments, sir?
I think you staff circulated the report from public industrial and public supply, and they had reports on all the water issues, things we've just been talking about, and then on cooperative funding and draft study of the Senate Bill 536, regional water supply plan, groundwater availability data, and so forth. So unless there are any questions, this will be, everybody's provided a copy, and public supply appreciates our input and the fact that they have a committee and they can give us input. So we appreciate their voluntary participation and help.
Thank you very much. I think Ms. Griffin has something to talk about Restore Act.
Yes, actually we have been included in the draft priority plan that was submitted by EPA to the Gulf Coast Council, and we have preliminarily been selected for one of the project awards. That would be our Palm River Habitat and Water Quality job, which would be about, it was through that National Estuary Program, and four of us, we all went together and then split the $2 million among all of us evenly, so we would be getting $271,430 extra that we hadn't anticipated. And we're looking forward to this because this gives us one of the first chances to prove what we can do with the money. And I think they'll be very pleased with what they see. We've done these, the district and the estuary program, and we know how to do them. We know how to do them right. And so hopefully this will lead to more funding next year.
Very good. Thank you very much for that report. All right. Are there any other reports today for the meeting? All right. Mr. Beltran.
I have nothing at this time. Thank you.
All right. Now we move to Chair's report. We have a couple of things we need to do. We have on employee milestones, we have Rick Judd for 30 years in the Brooksville Operation Land Management. Give him our congratulations. That's a long time. It's almost a long time as Mr. Baruch. Oh, I'm sorry. It's been six, right?
Feels like 30.
One other comment I want to make the staff aware of, the board, is that we all know that session is starting in September, right around the corner, and Mr. Rathke and Colleen, I'm sure, are getting ready, gear up to go to Tallahassee and keep us informed what's going on. I have been hearing that water is still a top subject, so we're looking forward from your reports as the session begins in September. We also have a special time here that I'm happy and sad about. I'm happy for him, but I'm sad that he's leaving. We have one of our board members, Mr. Baruch. This is his last meeting. And I think from the board, we want to say thank you. We have something for you. But Mr. Beltran, you want to take it from here?
I'll turn the floor over to Mr. Baruch and follow in his footsteps if I could.
I was going to just sneak out quietly.
Nice try. We're not going to let you go.
Come on.
I just want to say thank you. I've learned a lot. It's been a great experience for me. You guys do a great job. At the end of the day, I certainly believe that the Water Management District is more sensitive to the taxpayer dollars, which is what my mission has always been, which is to make sure we understand why we all work for them. And that the taxpayer dollar is even more important than our own dollar, because our dollars we can throw away. We can't do that with taxpayer dollars. And I think the district is much better off with the the leadership that this board has today and the executive team that you have. So thank you for allowing me to serve. It was a genuine pleasure. And you all can call me whenever you like, and I promise I won't send you a bill for my advice.
So, yeah, we have a couple things here for you, Mr. Baruch. Knowing how busy you are, knowing if we could ever tie you back down to coming back, we figured we'd take care of this right now. And I just want to take a second while they put that together just to thank you for all your leadership.
Is there a whoopee cushion?
Well, maybe. Well, we're not going to tell you what we're giving you. So come on up to the front.
All the black stuff.
Mr. Beltran, please.
I just, again, wanted to recognize Mr. Baruch and all his contributions he's given to the district over the last 6 years. He really has been a true leader for the organization, as all board members are, and part of our team as we've moved forward and enhanced the operations of the district, which then relates to better value and benefit to our public. So, again, thank you, Carlos, for everything you've done.
I wanted to thank Mr. Baruch. He brought something and shared it. I don't know if you gave everybody a copy, but his April 5th, 2010 memorandum to Mr. Frisch. And it's interesting to observe his comments at that time and what we accomplished along the way. And it's a testimony to your input and your leadership. Thank you. We'll miss you.
I'll miss you guys too.
Yeah.
It's just a little.
if you'll come back and visit, we'll double your pay.
Thank you.
All right. Please make note of the upcoming meeting locations listed at the end of today's agenda. Remember, September the 15th, we have a tentative budget hearing in Tampa, and September 29th, a governing board meeting and final budget hearing in Tampa. And October 27th, the governing board meeting will be in Brooksville. The public hearing is now in recess. May I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Carrie, this meeting is adjourned. Good job, guys. I can read blue.